in the Church of God, in a lot of churches, but whenever a visiting minister comes, you give him a little respect because God appointed him to minister the Word.
Amen.
I don't care if you're Baptist, Catholic, whatever. The Word's in it. If God tells you to give the Word, to give the Word.
Amen.
And they can give you a different Word than someone else can give you. But I just got a small thing here. I'm going to hand it over to Brother Odom. But I just want to say this today. So many times I hear people say, I didn't get anything out of that worship service. You know what? Too bad, because you weren't supposed to get anything out of that worship service. You're supposed to give in that worship service. So many times we're worried about what we get, and we don't worry about what we give. You see, it's not for you, it's for Him. It reminds me a little thing about a child going to a birthday party. You ever seen little kids that get there and they see the birthday kid and all of a sudden they start screaming and hollering? I'm talking about the kid that's not the birthday kid. They're all upset. You know, look at all the gifts they're getting. I'm not having fun. That's the first thing a kid will say. I'm not having fun at the birthday party.
All right.
Well, you know what? It's not your birthday. This cake's not for you. The presents aren't you. They're for the birthday child. Well, when we come to church, it's not for us. It's for God. We came to worship God. It's for Him, not for us. But when we praise Him, and we celebrate Him, and we worship Him, then we feel good. But you see, He comes first. You see, when you praise and worship, it's not about you, it's about Him. It's about you growing closer to Him. It's about you being prepared for the blood of Jesus. It's about worship. It's about, if you got that, you just won first prize. And first prize is what? Salvation. Now, I love music. I really love music. I love feeling, and I love the vibe that happens when you get in here. But you know, it's not the centerpiece of what we're here for. We're here for worship. You know, we have to ask ourselves, is our collection here getting together and worshiping? Not how good did we do, but how was it for God?
Amen.
We can leave this place and say, we had a great worship time, but God's up there saying, I don't think so.
Amen.
That's the question.
All right.
How did God receive the worship that you gave? But when we put our full heart into it, and there's not a set rule on how to worship. I don't have to worship with a Red Book hymnal.
That's right.
I don't have to worship with blues and R&B. Why? But I still have to what? Worship. And I need to give Him the glory. And if I'm going to sing rap, I'll give Him the glory. If I can sing R&B, I'm going to give Him the glory. But you see, the question is your worship. Are you giving Him the glory, or are you just trying to make yourself feel good? I'm not coming here for entertainment. I'm coming here to praise Him. I'm coming here to get ready for God. I want God to walk in this house. I want Him to help that lady right there. And I want to help everybody here. I'll worry about myself last. Like if you notice today, I'm sitting in the back. Because that's where I belong. God belongs up front. I'm going to be at the back. When God wants me, He'll call me. But it's about Him, not about me. You know, good worship service is received and accepted by the Lord. And that's when things happen.
Amen.
And right now, I just want to give it to Brother Odom. Praise be to God. But let me real quick, before we give it to Brother Odom, there are some people here. I want to make sure I'm going to say a quick prayer here. Really, it should never be a quick prayer. It should be a long prayer.
Amen.
But I'm going to do a prayer. There's some people here that are having some crib situations. I know that personally. Some alcohol situations that touch their families. And there's some people right now that are looking for a job. Brother Larry here has just stepped out of rehab. And he's going to face the devil full-hearted with no protection around him. But yet he's got protection. It's called God. And he's got to see that faith there. And we're going to have to pray for his faith. We're going to have to pray for everyone that's having problems at home, someone drinking, someone taking drugs, someone not accepting God. You see, God is here, we know it, but they want to push Him away. Let's pray that God will intervene and people will see the light and understand it's about how you love people, not how you degrade them. You see, the last thing here is when we come to worship, don't come with a fighting attitude, come with a loving attitude. Don't come to church after you've been yelling at somebody. You're not ready for God. Let God into your heart. going to start forgiving everybody. And you're going to see a change in your life. Let me lead off to prayer here. Lord, Father, I ask you to bless those right now that need you. Lord, there are some people right now that need you more than ever. They're calling up with you with their hands raised and surrendering. Lord, just as the police tell us to raise our hands and stop and give them us everything, we raise your hands to you, Lord, saying that you are mighty. We raise your hands to you, Lord, saying that you are everything. We admit defeat that only one can be holy is you. Lord, we raise our hands and surrender of our lives to you, Lord. But I ask you to bless those people right now. They need you right now. They're calling in the night, Lord. Let them know that you are there. Touch them. Praise them. Lord, just hold them tight, I ask you. All in the name of Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, Brother Owen. Brother Owen's going to give his word here. I love getting somebody else on the spot. Chestnut, when he was teaching me, did the same thing. In fact, I remember one time he was in the hospital, and he said, tomorrow you got to do a funeral for 250 people, and I had never done a funeral. I said, Pastor Chestnut, what am I going to do? He said, don't worry. I taught you. You know what to do. Get to it. And that was it. And you see, I love being able to tell somebody else that since I'm such a new minister. But here's Brother Owen.
Amen. To God be the glory. All that he has done. Amen. I truly want to thank God for each and every one of you. And amen. We all probably going through some trials and tribulations. Amen. But the way of the world. Amen. And everything. And amen. It's good. Amen. To come in and hear a testimony about somebody, you know, coming out of rehab. Amen. That is wonderful. Amen. If you really want to look at it, amen, with all of us coming out of the world into our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in the realm of life, we all came out of rehab, amen, and we are still in rehab, you might want to say, because every day we're running for our life, amen, because we want to make it into the kingdom of heaven, amen. What we need, God has, amen. The Bible says that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, amen. Everything that belongs to him, amen. Somebody might say, well, he haven't answered my prayers yet. Well, that doesn't mean that he's not. And maybe he has. Amen. Maybe what you was asking for, you really didn't need. Amen. See, we have to understand what the Bible said. He said, my God shall supply all our needs according to his riches and glory. He didn't say all of our wants. Amen. We're human beings. We get big at it. We figure everything that we see we want, we all need it. But it's not necessarily true. There's something that we need, and we probably have asked God for that we haven't got. Amen. And in your situation and mine, I can't tell you why he hasn't answered that problem, why he haven't given you that blessing. But let us not look at God as the problem. Amen. See, there's no problems in God. Amen. It's got to be in us. Amen. So what I do want to encourage you to do, though, if you're asking God for something, if you're seeking God for something, amen, this is what I want to ask you to do. And this was one of our Sunday school lessons, amen, a little while ago. Well, amen, we was encouraged to practice whole life stewardship. Amen. Look at yourself as being a problem and not God. Amen. Because we know the Bible tells us there's not a problem in the world that God can't solve. There's nothing he can't do. Amen. And we already know this. Amen. And so we was encouraged to practice whole life fellowship. And one of the things, amen, that we was encouraged to do by Apostle Paul, amen, if you want to turn your Bibles, amen, to Ephesians, amen, the fifth chapter. And I want you to look at verse 15, 16, and 17. Amen.
Praise the Lord. If you would, my hand, extend this a little closer to me here. Yeah.
I like to move my hands when I'm talking. Amen.
Amen. That's good. Amen. All right. Amen. Ephesians, the fifth chapter, verses 15, 16, and 17. Amen. And I want you to stand with me as we read.
God's word.
Amen.
As a matter of fact, I would like to have a reader. Amen. Somebody that don't mind reading. Amen. Read it, sir. Ephesians 5th chapter, starting from verse 15. Three verses.
15 and 17.
15, 16, and 17.
Yes. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Wherefore be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is.
Let us pray. Lord, let these few words be yours and not mine. Lord, take these scriptures right here and ponder it in the hearts of your people today. Lord, to really have an understanding of what the word is saying, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O God, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. Augustine, one writer, said this right here. He said, breathe in me, O Holy Spirit. You go ahead, baby. That my thoughts may all be holy. Act in me, O Holy Spirit, that my work too may be holy. Draw my heart, O Holy Spirit, that I love but what is holy. Strengthen me, O Holy Spirit, to defend all that is holy. Guard me then, O Holy Spirit, that I always may be holy. Amen. If we're going to practice wholehearted stewardship, holiness is to be God's standard of living for his people. Amen. Now, we're not just holy on Sunday. Amen. We're not just holy when we go to Bible study or prayer meeting, but we are holy every day. Amen. We live a godly life on our job. That doesn't mean that we're not going to endure circumstances. Amen. But we strive every day to live holy. Amen. And I want you to understand what the Apostle Paul, amen, was saying. Amen. Paul here, amen, was in a situation, and here he acknowledges his believers, amen, not to act unwise, but wise. There's a difference. All of us know the difference between wise, amen. We know the story about the wise and the foolish virgins. Amen. We all understand that story. Amen. They were all Christians. Was that right? Amen. Some of us wise and some of us foolish. Amen. Amen. And those that was wise, not only did they have oil in their lamp, amen, but they had extra oil. Amen. They didn't know when the bridegroom was going to come, but they know he was coming. Amen. But those foolish virgins, amen, those unwise, amen, well, they didn't take no extra oil. And so what happened while they were sleeping? Amen. Amen. They ran out of oil. Amen. And then they woke up and then they wanted the wives to give them some oil. And they said, well, we don't have enough for you and us too. So you got to go down the store and buy your own. Amen. So what happened while they were gone? The bridegroom come. Amen. Amen. So the writer is saying, amen, that, amen, be wise. Amen. Not as fools. Don't be foolish. Don't be a foolish Christian. How many of us know there's some foolish Christians? How many of us have acted like fools sometimes?
Well,
wow. I'll be the first one to raise my hand. Amen. Amen. Because you know all the time, you know all the time, you know how it is sometimes we act in self. That's not the Spirit of the Lord speaking. Amen. We get in self. Amen. We'll do anything, won't we? Amen. That's when we have to practice wholehearted stewardship. Amen. So Paul admonishes the believers here not to be paid in an unwise way. Amen. In other words, it don't make no difference what the situation is before you speak. Amen. Look to the Lord. If you have to say, well, I can't answer this problem. I can't deal with this right now. Give me a little time when I get back with you. Because sometimes we act out in anger. Amen. And we say the wrong thing. Amen. You know the thing that we used to do out in the world? Amen. Even though the Bible tells us that when we become Christians, the old things of our life is past and gone, and behold, all things are brand new. But guess what? This flesh ain't changed a bit. The same thing that you used to do out in the world is still hidden deep down in this flesh right here. Amen. But you know what? Because you have the Spirit of the Lord living in you, you bring your flesh under subjection.
Amen. That your flesh, that, and you resist the thing that the flesh wants you to do, to do what the Spirit of the Lord requires you to do. But sometimes when you act hastily, amen, your flesh rises up against you. Amen. And you begin to speak things that you know how you used to talk? Amen. And I don't want none of y'all around here. I'm going to tell these folks how I used to talk when I was out there in the world. Because I'm telling you, it was nasty. Amen. It was nasty. Okay, so don't even go there. Amen. I thank God that I didn't deliver. Amen. Amen. Talking about people's mama and all this stuff right here. That was a thing. I'm telling you right now. Amen. That's what people need to verify. Amen. You get from that gorilla juice, drink about a case of that butterfly, and anything will come out of your mouth. Called it having a good time. Amen. Slamming people. Cursing people. Yes. Talking about their mamas and all of this right here. We called it having a good time. We was foolish. Yes, we was. We was foolish. Amen. But I came to Jesus one day as I was. Weary, wounded and sad. And I found in him a resting place. Amen. He cleaned me up. He took them filthy words out of my mouth. Amen. He gave me a new way of life. I know how to talk to people now. I remember a time when, you don't have too many on the day, but those evangelists would come walk up and down the street, come all down there by the juke, down there where we partied and carried on, got all that beer and whiskey, and stare right in front of us and preach the gospel. Amen. We'll put a little money in his hand, he'll go on his way. Amen. He said, you ain't got to give me no money. I didn't come for your money. I come to preach to your soul. He said, thank you, sir. You heard everything you said. Amen. Amen. Lay the guilt trip on us. Amen. Amen. Said, man, I'm going to church tomorrow. Yeah, man, I got to go to church. My life is a mess. Let's go get another drink. That guilt trip didn't last long. But if we hadn't went to church the next day like we said we would have, you know, we probably would have got saved that same day, but we didn't. By the time we got that next drink, see, that idea of going to church was gone. Amen. Yeah. But one day, when Jesus did come into our life, he brought about a real change. Amen. That's the reason we're here today. We're not here just to occupy these pews, but we come to be fed bread from heaven. We're trying to grow. That's the reason we come to church. We come to church to worship the Lord. Amen. But we come to hear a rhema word from God. Amen. Because we need it every day in our life. And we need the word of God. That's our spiritual food. It feeds our soul, amen, that we will starve all doubts of the flesh. Is that right? Amen. And so Paul had the word, amen, for his readers. Amen. And he's telling them, amen, not to act as fool, not to behave as unwise. Amen. Because God has done something in your life. Amen. You listen to that still small voice speaking to you. Don't listen to what your flesh is saying. Amen. You see, your flesh will rise up against you in a minute. Amen. The enemy will make that flesh rise up against you. Amen. And so he says, wherefore ye be not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. Amen. How can we understand what the will of the Lord is if we don't know what God is saying? If we don't know what the word is saying, how are we going to understand what the will of the Lord is? There's just no possible way. Amen. So he's saying, listen. Do not behave unwisely, but with spiritual wisdom, amen, available through absorbing God's word, amen, feasting upon God's word, amen, he said, aided by who? The Holy Spirit, amen. He said, because he employs the metaphor of walking. We are told to walk, amen. Is that what he said? Walk circumspectly. Everybody know what that word circumspectly means? Huh?
Something special. Something better.
Something better. All right, sir. I'll take that. Amen. So he are saying we are to carefully walk. Amen. You don't walk any kind of way in the Lord. You don't act like a Christian any kind of way. Amen. Christians have a certain way they have to behave. Is that right? We don't act like the world anymore. Now, if you're saved, why are you still going to see James Brown? James Brown is dead. That's right. Okay? But you understand what I'm saying? Okay, if we are Christians, why are we still going to see BB? I'm calling all these famous songwriters that I was in love with. Amen. BB King was my favorite man. You understand what I'm saying? Well, if I don't got saved, I ain't got to be going to see BB King. Amen. I ain't got to be looking at BB King music, and I love music. I love music. Amen. Now, I'll tell you what I still listen at. I still love jazz because there ain't no words in it. That's music. Music coming from heaven. Amen. And I love music. I love to hear those instruments sound off. Amen. And I enjoy it. Amen. Amen. But I'm not going to go. Nobody going to entice me to go see B.B. King. Amen. I love B.B. King, but me and him dance to a different tune now. We don't dance to the same beat, though. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. So we have to understand, amen, and I ain't going to be before you long, amen, that time and time again, Scripture refers to Christians as being what? On a long life journey. Amen. We're on a journey. Amen. And when is that journey going to end? Amen. Not until Jesus comes. Amen. Amen. Or until we breathe our last breath. Amen. And that's fine and dandy because the dead in Christ is going to rise first. Amen. That's when our journey ends. Amen. So I heard, amen, the word says we are pilgrims and strangers in a barren land. Amen. So, but we are pilgrims with a destination. Amen. We have a destination. Amen. And I tell you something else. Amen. We have to fight on this destination. Amen. Because we got many Daniels calling and snare that we're going to endanger. Amen. So we got to fight and face all of these challenges and perils of life. Amen. So we need divine guidance and the help of more experienced believers so we will not squander our God-given resources. Amen. That's when we become in Him. We fellowship one with another. We can encourage one another. Is that right?
Amen.
We can encourage one another. Amen. So Paul is saying that we are to make the most of our time. We ought to redeem the time. Amen. We ought to redeem the time. Amen. Amen. And so how do we make the most of our time? We use it wisely. We use every available opportunity to us. Amen. To witness to somebody. Amen. To witness, to tell somebody about the goodness of God. To reach out and shake a hand. Show ourselves friendly one toward the other. To help somebody. To encourage somebody. Amen. We use our time wisely. Amen. And so we are commissioned by Christ to spread the gospel. Is that right? Amen. Amen. And we are admonished by Him to what? To occupy or be about His business. I heard one songwriter said, I want to learn this song one day. It's about God's business. It's about God's business. I want to learn that song one of these days. Amen. And it is about God's business. It's not about my business. It's about God's business. Amen. And it's going to be about God's business until He returns. Or until, amen, we leave this world. Amen. Our business is God's business. Amen. And so, and if we, amen, use the time wisely, amen, then we're going to take the advantage of every situation, amen, to talk about Jesus Christ to somebody. Amen. Amen. And so, amen. Paul said that in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus taught His disciples, amen, that you are the light of this world. Amen. Amen. We're the light out there in a dark world for those sinners out there. Amen. Just like when we was out there. Amen. Those Christians out there, they were the light in the world for us. Is that right? Every time we see them coming, they know they were godly. That's when we turned and went the other way most of the time. Uh-oh, there comes the preacher. He's like, wait a minute, son, come here, man. Oh, man, he got me. Amen. And so you stand there and you listen, and you talk, and he talked to you. And he's been a light in your life. We didn't receive it at that time, but he was. Amen. But he was being a light. Amen. And so, amen. So Paul implies that when we have spiritual wisdom, and therefore understand what the will of God is, we recognize the most strategic use of our God-given lifespan in our particular age and location. In light of the imminence of Christ's return, that strategy is to communicate the gospel through testimony, lifestyle, service to others in the name of Jesus Christ. And when we do this right here, I'm telling you, we are living and we practice wholehearted stewardship. All of us are stewards. We're disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen. You might be young in the gospel. You might be old in the gospel. Whatever it is, we all are disciples of Christ. God has given us a God-given talent. You might not be able to preach. Amen. Maybe you get a little interest if you're called to pray. Amen. But let me tell you one thing. God is going to groom you. Amen. He don't want you to stand still. He don't want you to be stagnant in His Word. Amen. But you have got to practice wholehearted stewardship. Amen. You got to study God's Word. You got to know what the Word of God is saying. Amen. You know what God, if you want to know what God want to do in your life, amen, you talk to the Lord. You say, Lord, here I am. Use me. He knows the talent that you have. Amen. He knows your abilities. And He's going to use them. He ain't going to call you to preach if you don't have the ability to preach. Is that right? No, sir. If you don't know how to sing, He ain't going to call you to sing. Amen. But if you strike a tune, go for it. All I can tell you. Amen. But use your God-given talent. Amen. Don't worry about how small it is. If He calls you to be a janitor in this church, give it your best. Amen. Give it your best. That's all you have to do. Practice wholehearted stewardship. None of us start from the top. Amen. And work our way down. But we have to start down and work our way up. Amen. Because we're going up yonder one day. Is that right? So we're working our way up yonder every day. Amen. So those are my few words to you today, is that you practice wholehearted stewardship. Amen. Don't let nobody deceive you. Amen. You are a child of God. You are a steward of God, and you live that way. Amen.
Right now, we're just getting ready to close the service. Today we learned a little bit about what worship is.
Amen.
But we need to come to church. And I'm not talking the building, I'm talking about worship.
Worship.
Church.
Amen.
Church of God. Yes, that's the church that's all around.
That's right.
Not just Church of God from Tennessee, but I'm talking about the Church of God.
Amen.
Prepare yourself for worship. You're going to fight in the morning with your kids, maybe you should stop. You can fight with your wife and your girlfriend. You just stop. Because, you know, when you come into church, you just can't just have your argument and put that fake smile and sit in the pew and say, everything's cool, I'm ready to worship God now. Your heart's not ready.
That's right.
You got anger in your heart. Imagine if Jesus was angry on that cross. He's sitting on that cross, getting tortured. I mean, people yelling at him. And one of the Roman guards turned around and said, he's praying for you. Can you imagine this? You're getting killed. You're dying. But Jesus didn't have time to worry about dying. He only had time to worry about praying. And maybe we should do the same thing. We spend our time worrying about what we can pray, and how long we can pray, and how we can pray, instead of worrying about how much fun we're going to have. Or what we're going to enjoy in life. My brother Odom says, it's his business. We're his employees, and we're about to have payday one day. Are you ready to receive that pay, or do you want it to be taken away from you? You got to say, God's going to say, let me look at your W-2. Let me see if you paid your taxes here. I see on that day last month about 2 weeks, you didn't pay your taxes. We didn't pay my taxes. Well, I saw that you just forgot about me. That's not paying my taxes. You see, we got to worry about God. Worrying about God is worrying about your brother and your sister. Take that phone call that's at 2 o'clock at night from that neighbor that you can't stand talking to because they don't know how to get off the phone. Maybe you don't know that in the next room, their husband's dying. Their mother's got cancer.
Uh-huh.
Their husband is drunk in a bar. You don't know why.
Amen.
There's a film we're going to watch next week, and it's 3 minutes long, and it talks about that.
Uh-huh.
Looking through, and we posted it on the internet. You can check it out. It's called Looking Through the World Through God's Eyes.
Uh-huh.
You see, we see people complaining, but God sees people having problems. I look at you, and I may see you cutting in front of me in the line at the store, and you're saying, well, man, I'm here first. But I don't see that you're working two jobs to pay the bills. Let's start looking beyond what we see. Start helping everybody. You realize the world's going to be a better place. That's what God wants. So pick up that phone. Listen to that person cry, and cry with them. And then do the hardest thing that is for a human to do. Don't talk about it afterwards. Don't go to work and say you won't believe what happened. Let God worry about that. That's what it's all about. Praise be to God. Let me just say a little prayer. Lord, if any of you all have received God at this point, I pray that you will. But if you've backslidden, let's pray for you. And I know every one of you has a family member or has a friend that hasn't had God in their life or has left God in their life or a boss or an employee. You know somebody somewhere, if it's not even just you. Let's pray for them right now. Dear Lord God, Father, I thank you in the name of Jesus for the blood that spilled on the ground that you're going to touch these people, that you're going to bring them forward, that when we go, when that time comes, I'm not going to walk to heaven alone. I'm going to walk hand in hand with all those friends, and hell is going to be a vacant sign. Only one person there, the devil himself. But Lord, I ask you to touch them right now and help those families, help those children. As I've said many times before, Lord, let them not know what the inside of a hospital looks like. Make the families allergic to divorce. Make them allergic to owing money to the banks. Give them a loving father and mother. And if they haven't loving father before, make them now. I ask all this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I'd just like to close it with a good worship song. As I always say, because you see, we need to leave this building here high-stepping, excited about God.
Amen.
I don't like to leave church on a somber note, because we need to learn, we need to leave out here rushing out there just so excited. We got to tell somebody about God. So, okay, just, it's all yours.
Okay, cool. All right, we're going to do, do a song.
All the musicians come up, please. I said, I want to thank you once again for coming to give us that word. It really touched my heart.
Amen.
Since he did so good in the sermons he gave us, we're going to do this thing called the way we used to have church in our hometown.
All right.